Praise the Lord, everyone. Welcome to the Christmas program evening. One really quick announcement, if we get everybody's attention. If you are not involved in the program, we ask that you sit in the middle two sections, the middle two areas, if you are not involved. And so if that, those are your designated places tonight. This is the day the Lord has made. Shall we rejoice? Will you stand with me and give the Lord some praise and some glory and some adoration? Holy God, you're so mighty. You're so wonderful. You're so awesome, God. You are holy and righteous, my King. You are wonderful. You are glorious. You are King and King forever. You are King of kings and Lord of lords. You're mighty. You're holy. You're sovereign. You are Jesus. Hallelujah. And we praise you and we thank you and we glorify you. We thank you, O God, for your mercy. We thank you, O God, for your grace. We thank you, O God, for your truth. We thank you, Jesus, for your holy name. We thank you for forgiveness and redemption. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for peace and joy. We thank you for the gift of the Holy Ghost. We thank you for the blood that you shed. We thank you for resurrection. We thank you for heaven. We thank you, oh God, for every great and precious promise. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. We do give you praise, Jesus. Glory to God. He's great, isn't he? He's mighty. He's holy. While we're standing, I'd like for us to take a couple of real needs to the Lord. We have several people who've been ill, and it's not good for people to be ill at all, but especially around the holidays, it gets very challenging. And people want to be with their families, and so a lot of times they're not able to be with their families for one reason or another. And we want to pray for these that are on the board here. Pete Zerbel gets to spend the holiday with his family, but he called and he's asked for prayer for a need that he has in his life. Sister Carol is in the hospital, and she's not doing real well. She's not responding to medication like she should. She has a swollen leg that's very confusing to the doctors. They're not sure exactly why. They know that she has an infection. They're just trying to trace that infection. They know it's coming from her kidneys, but they don't know where it's all going. And so we want to pray for her. Sister Sue Jeffers, we want to lift her up in prayer. And for this time, Brother Conrad is in the hospital down Madison. We want to pray for him as he's going through treatments and things. And it's Conrad and Leica's anniversary today. Happy anniversary. And God bless you. And Ron Mortensen is a man in the Charles City Church. Several of you have been to Charles City. You know who he is. He's been battling with some cancer and things, and so he's just not doing real well. But these are some needs here that we present, and we just ask that during the holiday season that you really bring a lot of these things to the Lord. These folks with illness in their lives and things, it's just going to be a real different time. They have the peace of God, but they don't have peace in body, and so we want them to have some good days. Amen. So if you will, then let's lift up the name of the Lord in all of the program and everything that's going to happen tonight. They've got a great program set up. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. If you'll just join with one another across the aisle or in front or behind you or whatever, if everybody could just join with somebody quick, and let's just go to the Lord. King of glory, merciful God, we push back, oh God, every unclean spirit tonight. We push back, oh God, every ungodly spirit. We push back every evil spirit, God. First and foremost, we are the authority, Jesus, because we carry your name and we carry your word. We carry your blood, oh God. Hallelujah. So we push all back, God. We push back sickness. We push back disease. We push it back right now in the name of Jesus Christ. So this gets its hands off of our brothers and sisters and off of our friends and relatives, God. Oh, Jesus, we pray, God, right now for the names that we brought forth tonight. Oh, hallelujah, for Brother Dennis and Pete Zerbel, oh, God, for Sister Elizabeth, and we pray for Conrad, and we pray for Sister Carol and Sister Sue, and we pray, Lord Jesus, for Ron Mortensen. We ask, oh, God, for the Spirit of the Lord right now to work mercifully, work with wonderful, wonderful mercy and truth and grace. Hallelujah. Let the grace of God focus on these souls, Lord Jesus. And we ask that you just direct this service tonight. Direct our worship, God. We want to worship you, Jesus. We want to praise you, Jesus. You are great and mighty and worthy. So we ask, oh, Father, tonight for the Spirit of the Lord to lead us and guide us. We ask, oh, God, for this program and the directors and everybody involved, Jesus. We pray, oh, God, for the anointing of the Lord. We want, oh, God, first and foremost, we want you to inhabit our praise tonight. We want to give you, Lord Jesus, more than just a little entertainment. But, oh, Father, we want to touch the throne tonight, Jesus. And we ask, oh, God, for every need in this congregation, every need that's in this building tonight. We ask for those needs to be met. We pray for the peace that passes all understanding to be upon each and every one. Hallelujah. Oh, Jesus, we praise you not in just this season, but we praise you year around. Jesus, you are worthy and glorified. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ, we declare your truth tonight. We declare your sovereignty tonight. We declare your kingship tonight. In the name of Jesus, we declare healing and salvation. In the name of Jesus, we declare power and truth to prevail. In Jesus' name, and we give you all praise, and we give you all adoration. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, church, will you praise him right now? He's worthy of it.
Oh, right now and tell him, Lord, you are awesome, Lord God. You are a mighty God. You have been that deliverer. You have been that protector, that provider, God. In the name of Jesus, he is that provider. Hallelujah. Go ahead and just speak out. He is that provider. Oh, he's provider.
Provider.
Not provider. Celebrates his birth. We want to just lift up, as Pentecostals, we want to thank him for being that one true God. Amen. That one God, not who sent his son down, somebody else, but wrapped himself in flesh and provided himself as that gift, as the Son of God. Amen. So as we sing this song, just lift up your voice and just worship that one true God, because there is one Lord, one faith, one baptism, amen. Let's lift up that mighty God as we sing to him in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for your mighty grace, Lord, for being that one. Thank you, Jesus.
One voice in the dark, a song that lights up the stars, one breath that gives life, one sovereign power.
The one.
lift up that name that we worship. Amen. In Jesus' name, Lord. Thank you, God.
Thank you so much. You can be seated. Thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight to see our presentation. A lot of work went into it. All of these guys put in a lot of hours. We're very proud of them. Hopefully, they won't let you down. Still a tough crowd tonight. All right. It was earlier, too. Tonight, this week, most of the United States, most of the world is going to be celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. Whether they know it or not, that's what they're celebrating. And there is some contention in the world as to whether or not God really exists. But of course, we know tonight that he does, and that he was born as a baby, but he was born for one purpose. We celebrate that he was born as a baby. Everybody loves babies. They're cute. They're helpless. They're so innocent. But he was born for one reason, and that was to die. He was to die for you and I. And so, although tonight we celebrate the birth of an innocent, beautiful baby boy, that baby boy was born to die. And that kind of contrasts with the message of an innocent, beautiful baby boy, because the reason he came in the first place is not so beautiful and not so innocent at all. He came because of the sins of the entire world. He came to take those sins upon himself, and he did that. We celebrate Easter, the death of Jesus. But tonight we're going to celebrate the birth of Jesus, and we celebrate the birth of Jesus because he did suffer and die for you and for me. He took my sin upon himself. He was sinless. He was perfect. But he decided he loved me enough, and he loved you enough to come down into the form of a man, live life just like you and I, and suffer and die on a cross to save you and to save me, to reestablish a relationship with humanity that he lost in the Garden of Eden. Finally, that bond, that relationship he wanted with humans would be reestablished. So, without further ado, please sit back, worship with us as we come to the manger.
Have I got a story to tell, one you may know very well. It has angels, shepherds, magi, and stars shining bright on this holiest of holiest Christmas Eve night. It's about hoping that good dreams we've long had will come true. It's a love story from heaven, a love story written for you. And with much anticipating, we've been a long time waiting for this day, so elating to finally be here. So without further ado, come, let me take you to the manger where all the hopes and dreams of the world will come true.
She is going to have a little baby, a perfect and sweet baby boy. And it's almost time for him to come and give the world great joy. And after such a long trip, she is most ready to rest. But all the rooms in this inn, in the inns of this tiny town are taken. But one innkeeper does his best.
He had no room in the inn. They were already packed to the brim. Like them, many had traveled so very far for the census that Caesar demanded, so he could boast and raise taxes. What he had, he gave. He was sorry. It wasn't much. It was a stable where animals slept. Tonight, maybe they can keep him warm and such.
So they went to the stable, and there Mary and Joseph were able to thank God for providing them some place and some peace. It was going to be a good story for the ages, at least. Because there, amongst oxen and donkeys and rams, strange noises and stranger smells, was born the great I Am, God's holy perfect lamb, a baby boy, heaven's joy, the savior of all man.
Jesus, God's only son, the perfect gift for a weary world. Jesus, God intended him for the manger and then so much more. Jesus, like a light in the darkness, he came to make hopes real. Jesus, who would be for all people, and we'll start with some shepherds in the field.
Come, all you shepherds, now's the time to tend to our flocks through the cold, cold, dark night. Come, shepherds, we need you in the fields here. The sheep are all bleating for their shepherd to come near. We work hard to protect our sheep, and when night comes, we are still working, even as we sleep on the cold, cold ground. There are wild animals all around. So we have to keep watch to make sure our sheep do not wander or get taken away. That's how we devote our lives each day. We are shepherds, and although we are very, very poor, we must be worth so much more than the dirt we sleep in on the floor. Because, well, wait and see.
Heaven is preparing a chorus to sing for the birth of a baby, Jesus, the King of Kings. So come, angels, come. From every corner of heaven, come. The Lord has summoned his heavenly host to announce this holy little one. We must tell the world of this gift God has given to all mankind. Come now, angels, ready yourselves to sing praises to God the Most High. Hark, ye herald angels, the heart of heaven has taken on humanity, God's love for all the eye can see. Born this day, just a tiny baby, but his love is huge, and we must say it loud. God himself to the earth has come down. We are the first in time to tell this timeless story of God taking off his glory and walking in his own story. Are you ready? Watch, and you will see nothing will ever be the same after this declaration we are making.
Something's moving, something's changing. See his glory, feels like heaven on earth. Something's moving, something's changing. See his glory, feels like heaven on earth. Something's moving, something's changing. See his glory, feels like heaven on earth.
Be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy. In Bethlehem, a baby is born, and he's so much more than just a little boy. He is for all people. He has been born for you. He is the Messiah. He is the Lord. Come and see him, all of you.
God wants to see us shepherds. He wants us to see the birth of his son. But who are we that God would want us to greet the Holy One? We are poor, nothing great. Could this gift really be for everyone? Are you sure that he wants us to come to the manger?
Jesus is a gift for all people, so don't be a stranger. He's just over there, poor, just like you, in a stable. All who are able, come to the manger. Angels, now is the moment. With joyful praises, we give glorious praise. Shout praises with me. Glory to God in the highest.
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 Heaven is calling for you to come higher. See everything from a new point of view. To be seated with Jesus in heavenly places. From his perspective, everything is made new. Oh, oh, oh. Heaven on earth. Oh, oh. Heaven.
Should we go to Bethlehem and see this gift of love sent from above that God has given to you and to me?
Yes!
Then come to the manger with me.
So these poor shepherds came. God himself invited them to see his gift for all people. They came to the manger on bended knee. And Mary, delighted to share Jesus with them, he'd grow strong and love all people, even the poorest like him.
And on that first Christmas day, in a land far away, some wise men stood gazing at the sky. For a star shone so bright, that holiest of nights, over Bethlehem. And the Magi wondered why.
Could this be? Was it true? I've heard about this, a light sent from heaven. We cannot dismiss this sign and a chance to go see this little baby born, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, the Messiah most holy. He is the one will save all there is to save. Come, we must go, though it be a long way. So come, all ye magi, come all who are wise enough to make the long journey and see heaven's eyes in the face of a child who gives love without bias to all nations, to all people. See the star like heaven's steeple. Come, we have a long journey ahead. Make haste, the road will be our bed until we can lay our head and our gifts at the feet of this little king. Come, all who are wise, and we will bring the very best we have to offer. We will empty our coffers, and still, could we ever bring enough treasures to honor such a king?
So these magi from far away, though the journey was so long, packed up their best gifts to bring to Jesus and went on and on for days upon days and weeks upon weeks until finally in Bethlehem they found what they went to seek. A sweet little boy, heaven's heart, the world's joy, a tiny little king who would bring peace to all from the very greatest to the very least.
We bring gold, we bring frankincense, we bring precious myrrh. We bring all that we have to honor this Savior. We lay down our gifts at this tiny treasure's feet. Come, Magi, lay down your gifts here. Do not keep anything from Jesus what you have to give. All who are wise, give your treasures. And when every treasure is given, then give how you live your lives every day. Live your life like a treasure of God's to give away.
My life is not my own.
To you I belong.
To you I belong.
Give myself.
Jesus, the hope of every man, woman, boy, and girl.
Like a light in the darkness, God's Son humbly came.
Like a light in great darkness, he carried the name of God to the orphans, the lonely, and the lame.
He brought hope to the hopeless, and he can do the same to those still walking in darkness who call upon his name.
The darkness is so dark.
The light is so dim.
Thank God for the star that guides us to him.
Darkness, loneliness, emptiness, fear. All who want the light to shine on them, come here to the manger. Come, follow the light that breaks through the darkness on the holiest of nights. So come, stars, it's our turn to shine. We will not let darkness hide this little light of mine. Come, stars, to the manger. Be the light in dark places. We'll shine bright and share the light across all faces of those who look to the heaven. This love born tonight erases any traces of darker ages. That first Christmas night, a single star shone the way to Jesus, proving one star, one little light, ultimately frees us from the darkness around us. This little light of mine can brightly shine, leading others to Jesus. So stars, stand and shine brightly on Christmas Day and every day after then. We are a bright city on a hill, not easily hidden. Be the light of Jesus wherever you may go and guide those walking in the dark to come to the manger, to come home.
Shine, let it shine, let it shine.
know you've heard the story you may have heard before of shepherds,
angels,
magi,
stars,
and Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us.
And I'm pretty sure it will not be the last time you hear this story of God's glory born in Bethlehem.
The story of God come down, born to be our friend.
He came for the poor.
He came for the rich.
And everyone in between.
He came to bring light in the dark, dark world.
He came for you and me.
Jesus came for all people that first Christmas day, those who were nearby
or far, far away.
Jesus came to show God's love walking around on the earth.
So on Christmas Day, we joyfully celebrate his gift, his birth.
So come, shepherds.
Come, angels.
Come, magi.
Come, stars.
Come however, wherever, whoever you are. With God, you're never a stranger. So come, everyone.
Come to the manger.
Forevermore, and he shall.
I'm so thankful to serve a mighty God that has risen.
Amen.
And through his birth and his death, we can be born again.
Amen.
So worship the Lord with us all as we praise the mighty God. One true and living God, and this world needs him. And in 2017, we need to be that conduit, that vessel that God works through. So this next song is a declaration of how much this world needs Jesus.
Fill up this space. My world
what I see. In God, please fix me. My world needs you.
My world needs you right now. Let us see you right now.
Yes, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah to my God. Is he worthy? He is worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. 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 Without the manger, you know, the Bible, or the song says, away in the manger, right? Away in a manger. Away. There is a way that came through a manger, and his name is Jesus. So we're going to sing some Christmas songs, and we're going to ask you to join in with us, okay? All right. One, two, three.
It's Christmas. Isn't God good? You can be seated for a few moments. Real quick, by way of announcements, next Sunday is Christmas Day, and so there will not be any services. Enjoy some time with your families, and be a blessing to your families, and let them be a blessing to you. So enjoy some time with your families on Christmas Day, and if you're traveling, we will be praying for you. If you're not traveling, we'll still be praying for you. So, sorry, you get prayer either way. hope you can handle that. But anyway, it's an exciting time of the year. Now, when January 1st comes around in 2 weeks, that seems strange, doesn't it, that it's already going to be 2017. But on New Year's Day, there will be an AM service only on New Year's Day. And so please come out for the AM service, and there will not be a PM service on New Year's Day. So again, enjoy some time with your family. Now, starting January 2nd, we will be engaged in 30 days of prayer and fasting as a church. We do not have a sign-up sheet going around. We just expect everybody to jump in with us. And so please be praying, please be fasting, and spend some time talking to, if you're a family, talk to your family members about when and how you're going to do that. Pray together. Please make sure you come out to the Tuesday night prayer services, prayer meetings. You will not want to miss those, especially in January. Those are going to be very power-packed in January. Of course, we don't want you to miss them anytime, but January especially, please come out. There's going to be different things going on, and not just prayer, but prayer will be made, amen? But there's going to be miracles. And so come on out and give your testimony. If nothing else, come give your testimony on a Tuesday night. It's only from 7 to 8, and spend some time with us praying and worshiping the Lord as we come together during that 30 days of prayer and fasting. We do not want anybody to be left out, because we want the miracles in every life. Amen? And so anyway, just be expecting God to do great things. He always does. He always does. And so I'm looking forward to February just blowing up with revival. We don't have to wait for February, but generally that's how it goes, is February becomes a big revival month, and everybody has a lot of personal revival. But you don't have to wait till February to have revival. You can have it tonight. Amen. And so anyway, and I don't think I have anything else that I really need to talk about. So I get to talk about Christmas for Christ. Yeah. CFC is a wonderful, wonderful thing. Mentioned part of it this morning. We talked about it. I talked about what I was going to share with us tonight for Christmas for Christ. If I could get your attention for the next few minutes, I want to go through these three gifts that were given to that baby Jesus. A lot of times we talk about the gold, frankincense, and myrrh out of Matthew chapter 2, and John chapter 19. We talk about the gold, frankincense, and myrrh. But a lot of times we really don't get a lot of the picture. I don't have a lot of time because I'm not going to preach tonight. But anyway, we don't get a lot of this picture. So I just want to go quickly through this picture. Anybody ever pay attention to essential oils? I know a lot of people are, you know, that's kind of a thing that's coming around again. Now I like essential oils because there's so many great things in the Bible about the benefits of these things, but gold is not an oil. Hopefully you know that. Do you have the PowerPoint loaded? Should be in your email. I'm noticing the CFC stuff up there, but I don't see the PowerPoint. So, but anyway, gold represents king, royalty. It's a precious metal, obviously. Most of you know it's a precious metal. Jesus presented a kingdom of different riches, didn't he? He presented a kingdom of very, very different riches. And so John 19, we see Jesus as king, and we recognize that he has a royalty about him. He's such a royal king. His kingship is fully revealed after his death. It's not fully revealed before his death. It's fully revealed after his death. And so we also know that he's the King of Kings and he's the Lord of Lords. We understand that. Of course, they didn't understand that then. But these wise men that brought these gifts to the baby Jesus, they recognized there's royalty here. And so they would bring gold to him. Gold is for us to recognize that his kingdom is with us. Now, Mary and Joseph would have had to use that gold in their trip to Egypt when they had to flee to Egypt to save Jesus because Herod was killing all the infants. So they would have had to use that gold. The gold didn't benefit Jesus directly. The gold benefited Mary and Joseph directly, but it represented the king that they were protecting. God is making gold out of you and I. That's what he's making out of you and I. He's making a precious, precious substance out of us. The next one is frankincense. Now, this is going to refer to his priesthood. Of course, frankincense, we recognize, is a resin that came out of a tree. And they would, a lot of times, how they would harvest the frankincense is they would slice the bark of the tree until it would bleed. That's what they would call when the sap comes out. They would call it bleeding. And as the tree would bleed, this resin, this sappy substance, and then overnight it would cool, and then it would kind of crystallize a little bit of a, it'd get a little bit of a crystallized outer casing on it. They would go around to these trees, and they would pick these little nodules off, and they would use them as incense. Of course, we first see that being used in the tabernacle in the wilderness. But the priest's role was to offer sacrifice. Jesus was, of course, our supreme sacrifice, but the priest's role was to offer sacrifice. And they would put this incense on the fire so it would burn and it would cover up the scent of death. Death has a stench. To cover up that scent of death meant that they were covering the scent of our sin. It symbolically was covering not just the death of the sacrificial animal that they threw on the altar, but it was recognizable as that's our sin. That's what it smells like to God. It's a stench that goes up into the nostrils of God, and it has to be covered with something. So they brought frankincense to this baby Jesus. Of course, we see later on in his life, we see as the frankincense is used in different things, and we can understand how a lot of this worked, but it covered up our sin, definitely not his. It covered up the stink of our sin, not his. It covered up the death that he died so that we wouldn't have to. This was a gift brought to Jesus. Something that would cover, something that would smell better. And then, of course, the myrrh is representative of the Savior. The myrrh is a bitter seed that actually it's another resin that comes out of one major tree that they would get the resin from. Otherwise, they would crush the myrtle flowers. But they would get the resin from a myrrh tree, which is a thorny, scraggly-looking tree. There's nothing desirable about it. And they would slice again the bark. In the heat of the day, the resin would bleed out. And then the cool of the night, the resin would solidify and get an outer shell. And that was more of a brownish, kind of a very bitter. Both frankincense and myrrh are very, very bitter to taste. But when you burn the frankincense, it becomes a sweet odor. When you crush or break the myrrh, it becomes sweet. It's bitter to begin with, but when you break it, it becomes sweet. Just like the Word of God can be bitter to our souls, but as long as we're willing to break so that God can sweeten us, our lives become sweeter. Both of these, frankincense and myrrh, of course, we know gold. We know the benefits of gold. We use that in our economy so we can understand the benefits of that. But there's myrrh has some health benefits that many people don't recognize or don't know. It can provide relief from inflammation. It's a real lot better than ibuprofen. It protects against microbial infections such as fever and food poisoning. It strengthens the immune system and stimulates blood circulation. It protects wounds from infections and it helps them heal quickly. It strengthens your gums and prevents hair loss and helps in muscle contraction. There's a lot of benefits to myrrh. The taste is bitter. It's pungent. But it has incredible benefits for us. Often, we ignore the benefits of the myrrh. If you recall, Queen Esther, before she was the queen candidate, she was just a candidate, she bathed for 6 months in myrrh. What that would do for her is it wouldn't just sink into her skin, but it would remove every single blemish on her. It would make her hair shine, and she would look so beautiful. It would fix anything, any blemish at all in her skin. If she had a bruise, it wouldn't have to go through the process that bruises go through as far as getting purple and yellow and green and all that. It would just heal as it soaked into the body. It would just heal every blemish. If you wanna get healed quickly, get the myrrh applied to your life. It's amazing what it does, and it smells sweet as well. It's nice to know that Jesus Christ applies myrrh to our lives. It's nice to know that when we get saturated with the glory of God, that our lives don't just smell sweet, but the healing that takes place takes every blemish off of our soul. That's what it does for us. Frankincense has a lot of health benefits. It lowers your blood pressure. It relieves pain. Imagine that. Both myrrh and frankincense are pain relievers. And we think OxyContin has to do the job. The Lord gave us the right stuff in the scripture. For ladies, frankincense will help fade stretch marks. For men, it'll fade your scars. It improves your digestion. It has anti-aging properties for all you who really think you're getting old. It boosts your immune system, and it helps your wounds heal faster. It's a powerful antiseptic. Now, when you think of this, both of these have health benefits. But it wasn't just the health benefits that made the wise men bring the gifts to baby Jesus. Because the benefits didn't really assist him. The benefits are for us. It's amazing how when you give a gift to Jesus Christ, it really doesn't assist him. It's for furthering the gospel. When we come for Christmas for Christ, we bring our gift to the Lord. Our gift is mostly, it's our gold, it's our treasure, if you will, that we bring to him. But the treasure that you bring to the Lord Jesus Christ will bring some spiritual frankincense and myrrh to other souls. It helps other people tremendously. It's not just an offering. It's not just giving a dollar or giving $100 or $1,000. It's so much more than that. It plants churches so that people have a saving station to come to. So people can come and the spiritual frankincense and the spiritual myrrh can be applied to their lives. It's so much more than just putting some money in an offering plate. It serves a larger purpose than we are really aware of. We saw the Magi bring the gifts symbolically, obviously, tonight, as the program showed us. But even if this baby was real, and even if this was the real Mary and Joseph, they couldn't have applied those gifts to that child. We see later on myrrh and frankincense are both applied to him, but it wasn't the myrrh and frankincense that was brought here. It was myrrh and frankincense that was applied from another source. When we bring our gift to Jesus, we bring our gift and we may never have that particular gift applied to us. But somewhere down the line in life, that gift is going to come back around and it's going to be applied. You see, we can't give with an expectation of direct return. God, I'm giving you this because you're going to give me a whole bunch more. No. We understand when we give, it comes from a lot of other sources. We need to really understand when we give a dollar, that doesn't mean we get $10 back. You could get it back in the form of your family is still together. You could get it back in the fact that there's peace in your home and there's joy in your lives. You could get it back in the fact that your children never fall into drug addiction or alcohol addiction or worse, whoredom. You could get it back in the fact that there's protection over your family. How do you put a dollar amount on that? You could get it back in the fact that your parents or your children or some other relatives or friends or somebody finally says yes to that Bible study and finds an altar of repentance and gets themselves in the kingdom. How do you get a dollar figure out of that? You can't place a dollar figure on something like that. You can't place a dollar figure on an angelic host over your home. You can't place a dollar figure over peace that passes all understanding. When the storms of life are raging, you walk in peace with the Prince of Peace because you were faithful in bringing your gold, frankincense, and myrrh to the King. Every year we take a Christmas for Christ offering. It's not just one time that we take the offering. It's over the course of a couple of months. Every year we ask for you to give your greatest gift to Jesus Christ. I don't know if the wise men, if they brought their gold, frankincense, and myrrh, if that was their greatest gift or not. But I know when the Lord is making gold out of me, and when he applies frankincense and myrrh spiritually to my life, I can't put a dollar figure on it. I know that every time I take a breath of air, knowing that it was supplied by the God of all creation. I can't put a dollar amount on that. So will you give your greatest gift to Jesus Christ? As our ushers come tonight, I know that several have already pledged and several have already fulfilled their pledges. Thank you for that. Thank you for pledging and fulfilling your pledge. We asked this morning that if you could, before you left, if you could give tonight to pick up one of the envelopes. There's still several out there. And I don't know if anybody really did that or not. I don't know if there's any envelopes back out there or not. Are there envelopes out there? There still are. We're going to go to the Lord in prayer here in just a little bit. It's not just going to be God bless what we give, but I want us to pray sincerely, asking the Lord, what can we do, Father, for your kingdom? Now, many of you understand, we save a lot of this right here to fulfill all of our global and home missions commitments from home. A lot of our CFC money, we don't send it all to the district and let them figure it out. We take a pledge, we give that pledge to the district, and everything that's left over, we keep home, and that takes care of the missionaries and everything that we've committed. Isn't it nice that we don't have to take a missionary offering every month? Because we take the CFC pledges, and so far, everyone has given enough to fulfill those missionaries, and we thank you for it. So if we go to the Lord in prayer, and if you don't have an envelope and you feel led to pick up an envelope, there's a lot of denominations out there. You can, they're coming in right now. If you feel led to just pick up an envelope, all these envelopes, however, the amount that's on the envelope is the amount that you place in the envelope. This one is $13. You would take this, you would put $13 in there and put it in the offering. If you want to come by, there's a lot of, all the way up to $71. And so, and a few in between. If you would like to take that, you don't have to put it in the offering tonight. But we ask that you bring an offering to the Lord tonight. But if you could pick up this envelope, whatever you feel led to give, if you feel led to give an exponential amount, then you can multiply that up and you can stand here for 20 minutes and pick out the cards. I don't care. But somebody wants you to play really bad. And so anyway, if we could stand tonight, and we want to go to the Lord in prayer, and please take this seriously. We rack our brains trying to figure out what we're going to give for gifts to people. This is something that you don't have to think about. You just give. And it goes to build churches, goes to start churches and plant churches. And would you go to the Lord in prayer with me right now, and let's sincerely seek the Lord for what we can give. Father, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we come to you tonight, O King. We are a blessed people. We give, O God, gifts to people, Lord Jesus, during this time of the year. But God, I cannot forget the Savior of the world. I cannot forget that I need to give into the kingdom during this time of the year. Jesus, I must put you first in everything. And that includes everything financial as well. God, I want you to be the God, and I want you to have the wisdom, and I want you to give me the wisdom and the understanding. And I want you to teach me to budget and to manage money. So, God, I'm going to make sure you get everything first, because it all comes from you. I'm not about to try to step out and do things avoiding you and keeping you out of the loop and trying to maneuver around you. But Jesus, you've called me to be a steward of the earth, and what I receive comes from the earth. So I'm asking you, King, tonight, to stir our hearts. Stir my heart. Lead and guide us, Father. Help us, Lord. They brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh to you when you were just a babe in the manger. It was applied later on in life, before you were crucified. And even after your crucifixion, they came to apply again. But Jesus, you've applied it to our lives. You've applied it to my heart more often than I can even begin to count. You've healed me. You've taken away all scars, all bruises. You've led me. You've guided me. You've changed my life. And what I have in my pocket is gold that comes from you, King. So I ask you, Father, tonight, very sincerely, to touch our hearts and lead us and guide us, because there's no king like our King. There's no God like our God. In the name of Jesus Christ, lead us and guide us tonight, Father. We give you glory and we give you praise in Jesus' name. And tonight, would you take a little bit of time and would you come and bring your gift to Jesus Christ? After you've given, you can consider yourselves dismissed and head to the fellowship hall.